Okay. Well, hello, everybody.
Hi.
Welcome to Stillwater Book. My name is Steve Porter. I'm the owner, along with my wife, Dawn, of the store. Probably, for some of you, it's your first visit, so we appreciate you coming in. We've been open here since March 1st. And we love our location, and we love being part of the downtown Pawtucket revival. So this is one of many events we're going to have going on over the course of the next 3 or 4 months. Probably you'll see something announced. You know, I invite you to join our email list. So if you haven't, if you're not getting announcements, we can get you those so that you can see that the events coming up are really amazing. We have about 15 to 20 different events scheduled next week. We're doing a presentation by Steve Mason, who's a photographer here in the city of Pawtucket, on a company called Weaver's Lace, which is the last lace mill to produce real lace. And it's even been ordered by the royal family in England, wedding dresses and other things. And it's located here in Rhode Island. It's the last one in the country that still creates that. And he's going to be talking about that next week. But tonight we're here to talk about history seen through the eyes of public art. And it's based on the book Monumental, Providence that was published through Stillwater River Publications, which is part of the company that my wife and I operate. It was written by Paul and Heather Caranci. We're here tonight to talk about this. We're very happy. I've known Paul and Heather for many years through working with them in their books, as well as through the Association of Rhode Island Authors, a 501c3 nonprofit that represents over 280 published authors who work, write, and publish here in Rhode Island. So without further ado, I'll introduce you to both Heather and Paul Caranci. Thank you.
We only have one microphone, so my wife tells me I don't need a microphone. So we'll let Heather have that. Thank you, Steve and Dawn, for your invitation to speak here tonight. And not only is this Rhode Island's newest bookstore, but by far it's Rhode Island's best bookstore. This place is amazing. And a new customer that's going to come every day. She said so. Her picture's going up on the wall later. So I think it's fair to say that writing this book was the most rewarding and fun experience. It was the first time that my daughter Heather and I were able to collaborate on a writing project. And the experience turned out to be quite a fun family activity for all of us. Find out later who the all involves, if you haven't looked at these photographs yet. It also turned out to be a very educational and eye-opening experience for us as we developed a whole new appreciation for public art. We hope that during the presentation, we'll do the same for you. Paul Campbell, the former archivist of the city of Providence, wrote, "Public art is everywhere and has served as an artistic form of cultural memory since the dawn of civilization. Many of the more monumental expressions of this form of remembrance are familiar icons. Witness, for example, the prehistoric Stonehenge in Wiltshire, England, that was begun in 3100 BC, or Egypt's Sphinx. The Great Sphinx of Giza is a limestone statue of a reclining or couching Sphinx that stands on the Giza Plateau on the west bank of the Nile River in Egypt, and it may have been constructed even before the Fourth Dynasty. The Eiffel Tower and America's Statue of Liberty are obvious examples of this form. While relatively little is known about the origins of the prehistoric art forms, we know plenty about the spectacular artistic productions of more modern times. The Eiffel Tower, for example, was designed and built by Gustav Eiffel in 1889 for use as the entrance of the 1889 World's Fair. Initially criticized by some of France's leading artists and intellectuals for its design, the tower has become a global icon. It's the most visited monument in the world and the tallest structure in Paris. The equivalent of an 81-story building, this 62-foot tall Goliath surpassed the Washington Monument as the tallest man-made structure in the world during the time of its construction. Perhaps America's most recognizable statue, Lady Liberty, was designed by French sculptor Frederick Bartholdi in collaboration with Gustav Eiffel. Unlike Eiffel's previous work, however, Liberty's design and construction were considered an engineering masterpiece of the 19th century. The pedestal was designed by American architect Richard Morris, and the entire art form was completed in 1884. The statue came to America in 350 parts, was packed in 214 crates. Lady Liberty was dedicated on October 28, 1886. It weighs 450,000 pounds, is 305 feet 6 inches tall, and has a waistline of 35 feet, just a tad bigger than mine. Yes, public art is everywhere. It's all around us. Yet some of these artistic masterpieces seem to hide in plain view, with thousands of otherwise unsuspecting and preoccupied passerby walking or riding past each day without even as much as a notice. Rhode Island School of Design Assistant Professor of Sculpture Richard Jordan noted the irony when he, in 1980, so profoundly wrote, "Public sculpture is very difficult to see. On the immediate level, what is going on around it, behind it, or sometimes on it, can be as engaging as, or sometimes more engaging than, the sculpture itself. We pass by sculptures every day without noticing them because they are mute, frozen helplessly in time, while we have the ability to move, even to move away."
Sometimes public art is noticed, but it is not viewed by the public as art. Structures are sometimes looked at as a building, and modern art is sometimes regarded as a scrap heap. But art, it certainly is, each with its own distinct look, some with a look of grandeur, and others with a deceptive appearance of neglect. It is, however, all art, and it is everywhere. Well, our book is called Monumental Providence, and none of these previously mentioned art forms appear in it. So you might be asking, what in God's name did they write about? Monumental Providence captures the stories of legends from history and literature and public art in Providence. It pays tribute to those who so bravely defended our freedom in the nation's various wars. It tells the story of amazing love, bravery, and valor of everyday Americans and provides insight into the spirit of man as interpreted by some of the most amazing artists that the United States has ever known. Public statuary first appeared in Rhode Island in the mid-1800s. Greco-Roman in origin, these masterpieces flourished, and the resulting statues, sculptures, monuments, and memorials, collectively known as public art, stand as a testament to the people, places, and events that have had a profound impact on the shaping of the history of Rhode Island's capital city. Providence is home to the greatest amount of public art in the state, and it is also the site of the state's first statue, Benjamin Franklin.
In 1855, the Franklin likeness was placed in front of the Franklin Lyceum building on Westminster Street. In 1926, it was moved to the lobby of Citizens Bank at 87 Empire Street. Richard Greenough's production of Franklin was cast in zinc and featured the founding father with his tricorn hat tucked securely under his arm. The statue has disappeared since then, however, and the exact whereabouts today is unknown. Though in 2010, it was spotted in one of the Citizen Bank branches, shrouded in a coat of gold paint. George M. Cohan composed hundreds of songs, many of which have gone on to become American classics. In fact, many, such as "It's a Grand Old Flag" and "Over There," helped improve the morale and support of the war effort. Cohan was born in the Providence neighborhood of Fox Point on July 3, 1878. In 1941, Cohan received the Congressional Medal of Honor from Franklin Delano Roosevelt, and is arguably one of the greatest song and dance artists ever lived. This is Robert Shaw Monument, dedicated on July 3, 2009. Stands as a testament to his Providence roots and marks the place of his birth. Have a listen. This song will be in your head for the rest of the night. Thank you. Charles, how much time do you have? While Ben Franklin has been momentarily lost to history, Providence is home to no less than 14 statues and memorials that commemorate the valiant effort of so many Rhode Island men and women who served in one of the many armed conflicts throughout our young nation's history. There are three monuments that pay tribute to the bloodiest war in our nation's history, the Civil War. Two are located in Roger Williams Park. One of these is a commemorative statue of our country's 16th president, Abraham Lincoln. Created by local sculptor Gilbert Franklin, this life-size bronze is mounted on a 10-ton granite base and depicts the wartime president in classic pose with arms resting by his side and wearing traditional period clothes. In his right hand appears to be a piece of paper, perhaps his notes or a speech from Gettysburg. According to Roy Basler, American historian and Lincoln expert to the Library of Congress, the sculptor caught the president just after giving the Gettysburg Address. Basler spoke at the dedication ceremony in the early 1950s and proving that not even statues are immune from political commentary, cited Lincoln's tolerance, perhaps as a counterpoint to the spirit of McCarthyism that pervaded the period in the 1950s. The Skirmisher, a statue cast in tribute to the Union soldiers of Civil War, was dedicated in 1898. This full-length bronze was cast by the Gorham Company of Providence and is a reproduction of the Cohagen statue originally cast for placement at Gettysburg in honor of the soldiers of the 39th Pennsylvania. He's wearing a military uniform of a Union infantry soldier and appears determined in his ascent up an imaginary hill. He brandishes a bayoneted rifle in his right hand. This 1895 design was the first full-length bronze ever cast by the Gorham Company. While the Pennsylvania version is known as the Skirmisher, the depiction in Roger Williams Park is referred to simply as the Union Soldier. He was gifted to the city by the Providence Association of Mechanics and Manufacturers and placed near the Temple to Music at its 1898 dedication. In 1993, however, it was relocated to the eastern entrance of the park on the Miller Avenue traffic island, where it is mounted on a large boulder. One of the most significant of Providence, or magnificent, of Providence's monuments is the Soldier and Sailor's Monument in Kennedy Plaza. Designed by Randolph Rogers in 1866, this beauty cost $60,000 and was dedicated on September 16, 1871, in front of Harrington Opera House, the site where the Providence City Hall now stands. The statue was topped with a bronze standing figure. From her perch 40 feet above the ground, the woman bronze is classically draped and extends a laurel wreath from her right hand while holding a wreath of immortelles with her left. Below the 10-foot figure of America, on perches of blue westerly granite, stand four additional bronze statues. Huh? Yeah.
Come out? No. She's got a little background thing going on. It's okay. It's okay. Yeah. Okay. The infantry soldiers do not want to leave.
Bearing the attributes of weapons of a branch of the service he represents, the infantry, artillery, cavalry, and navy. Below each military statue is a bronze honor roll listing the state's war dead. These alternate with relief panels depicting portrayals of war, victory, peace, and history. One of those relief panels, the one called History, is one of the earliest representations of an African American in the history of American sculpture. It depicts a black figure in classical dress about knee length and exhibits the broken shackles of emancipation. One tier lower, four cannon rest on individual granite platforms, while one tier below that rest eight mounds of cannonball, separated by four sets of granite steps that lead from the ground to the base on which the military statues stand. The Soldiers and Sailors Monument was sculpted in Rome, moved to Munich, and assembled in Providence by the architect. In 1913, the monument, which is among Rhode Island's most elaborate and beautiful, it was relocated to the center of Kennedy Plaza, where it underwent restoration in 1992. It was relocated back to its original and current location in 1997 as part of the renovations to Kennedy Plaza. This monument is now the subject of a $300,000 restoration project being undertaken by the Downtown Providence Parks Conservancy. Fundraising for that project has already begun. Sitting atop the tallest of the city's monuments is the heroic figure of peace, designed by Paul C. Genoin and sculpted by Italian sculptor Vincenzo Fiorito. From her station 150 feet above the ground, peace keeps a watchful eye over the Providence River and casts a long shadow on the leached judicial complex behind her. This fluted monument is a westerly granite column erected in 1929 as a memorial to Rhode Island's war soldiers who defended our freedom in the First World War. At its polygonal base are steps leading to the shaft from every direction. The first step is decorated with bronze panels depicting ships, planes, and other implements of war. The plinth contains four large faces inscribed with the words from the city's dedication at the monument and with quotes from Presidents Lincoln and Wilson, as well as poet Ralph Waldo Emerson. Between each face is an insignia of a different branch of military service. The lower part of the column contains a memorial frieze, the ornamented sculpted band that horizontally encircles the shaft, representing the virtues of Rhode Islanders that participated in the war effort. The names of the major battles of the war in which they fought are emblazoned above the frieze. The monument was commissioned by the City of Providence and was designed as a result of a competition that was won by architect Paul Krett, whose other local designs include the football stadium at Brown University. These nostalgic photographs from 1928 and 1932 show the construction of the monument's base and the completed monument at its original location in Memorial Square, now Kennedy Plaza. Notice how similar all the cars were back in 1932. Can you imagine how long it would have taken him to find his car if Clay Pell had been alive back then? This pair of photographs from 1987 show the Statue of Peace being hoisted back onto the top of the monument shaft and then being lowered back into her position overlooking the Providence River from a height of 150 feet. The photos were taken during the reconstruction of the monument following its relocation from Kennedy Plaza to Memorial and War Veterans Park. In the green just below, just south of the World War I monument, stands the memorial honoring the 96,000 local men and women of World War II. Dedicated on November 11, 2007, this circular colonnade is 16 feet in diameter and has 8 round granite columns, each measuring 14 feet in height and spaced at a distance of 3 feet. The granite floor within the columns depicts a flat map of the world with numbers referencing the location, easy for you to say, the location of the war's major battles, which are inscribed on the inside face of the column bases. Capping the monument is a 4-foot wide granite capital and cornice, bringing the total height of the monument to 18 feet. This monument is surrounded by a granite circular retaining wall measuring 3 feet high, on which are displayed the crest of all 39 Rhode Island municipalities. Two granite pylon walls containing the honor roll of the 2,560 Rhode Islanders who died in the conflict flank the entrance. Finally, four contemplation benches are stationed in front of the honor roll, two in front of each wall, allowing visitors to view the inscribed names of those who made the ultimate sacrifice for their state and country. Each bench is inscribed with one of four freedoms that was cited by President Franklin Roosevelt in his address to Congress on January 6, 1941. Freedom of speech and expression and freedom from want are on one bench, and freedom of worship and freedom from fear grace the other. This monument embodies the conception of World War II and Korean War veteran Joseph T. Caranci of Cranston, who was a major force in the monument's construction. Professional services for the monument were provided by Paul Cavanaugh.
Some of the most beautiful examples of public art appear at the college campuses in Providence. Not surprisingly, some of the most confusing are located there as well. Brown University, one of the nation's oldest universities, boasts the most examples of public art with no less than 16 sculptures, statues, monuments, and memorials located on the sprawling campus. Perhaps the greatest of all Roman emperors, Augusto was raised by his grandmother, who just happened to be the sister of Julius Caesar. Following Julius's assassination on the Ides of March in 44 BC, Augusto, born Gaius Octavius, learned that he was to inherit 2/3 of Caesar's estate. Caesar, it turns out, had no sons and had adopted Octavius as his main son and main heir. The reign of Augusto was relatively peaceful and became known as the Pax Romana, or the Roman Peace. He died at the age of 75 on August 19th, 14 AD, after a short illness that some believe was brought about at the hands of his wife, who may have poisoned him. Husbands beware. Dun, 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 dun. In 1854, Brown University graduate Moses Brown Ives Garden chose to honor Augustus with a bronze statue that he gifted to the university on September 19, 1906. He commissioned the statue to be an exact replica of the Augustus of Prima Porta statue currently located at the Vatican Museum in Rome, Italy. The original is one of the most iconic pieces of classical art, as it embodies Greek sculptural traditions. The Brown University version is a painted bronze cast at the Nelly Foundry in Rome and depicts the life-size Augustus standing in half stride. His right arm, which has essentially been missing ever since it was damaged in the Great Hurricane of 38, was in an upraised position. He is clothed in a decorative military Roman military uniform and toga fabric that originally held a staff that, like his right arm, is now missing. A genie figure on a dolphin rests by his right leg. Originally located on the main green in front of Rhode Island Hall in 1906, the statue was relocated to its present location in front of the Shop Refectory in the Riston Quadrangle in September of 1952. The move caused quite a stir among students, however, as was illustrated in an editorial by the Brown Daily Herald, in which the writer noted that his, Augustus's, presence among Georgian colonial architecture is one that Caesar, the esteem, would have wore. The newest memorial to grace the grounds of Brown University acknowledges Rhode Island's early economic dependence on slave trade and the role that Brown's founders played in the triangle trade of rum, slaves, and molasses. Martin Puryear, one of America's most accomplished contemporary sculptors, designed 2 of the 3 pots of the memorial. The third part was the brainchild of Joanne Conklin and the Brown Public Art Committee. The first element is a partially submerged giant ball and chain with the third link of the chain broken, symbolic of the end of slavery and celebrating the freedom guaranteed to all men by the Constitution. The second element is a nearby cylindrical granite plaque inscribed with information acknowledging Brown University's 18th century connection to the transatlantic slave trade. The location itself becomes the final element as it is located near University Hall. Built in 1770, University Hall is the oldest building on the campus and was constructed with the support of at least 3 slaves. Those who have seen the Dan Brown movie Inferno might recognize the story of Dante. The bronze bust of Dante, the esteemed author of the Divine Comedy, was sculpted by Paolo Iabati after the state's Italian community commissioned the work to commemorate the 600th anniversary of Dante's death. The Middle Ages poet claims to have fallen in love with Beatrice Portinari at the age of 9, effectually setting an example of courtly love developed centuries earlier in French and provincial poetry, and his love for Beatrice would ultimately become his reason for poetry and life. The rest of Dante's moving story can be found on pages 22 to 24 of the book. The oldest and perhaps most recognizable monument on the Brown campus is the Carré Clock Tower. The tower was the gift of Paul Bagnati, an Italian count and diplomat, following the death of his wife Carrie Brown Bagnati in 1892. Theirs is a moving love story much too involved to get into during this short presentation, but I encourage you to read about it in 2 different parts of the book, the Carré Clock Tower on pages 35 and 36, and the Bagnati Fountain on pages 277 to 279. Paul Bagnati commissioned both the fountain and the clock tower. The clock tower is the second of these monuments. It was constructed in 1904 at the corner of Prospect and Waterman Street. Following a long competition for the perfect architect to design and oversee construction, Bagnati chose Guy Lowell. Lowell certainly turned out to be the right choice, as the tower is among the more beautiful monuments in the city. Lowell was later selected to design the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. To many casual observers, metamorphosis may simply blend into the landscape, appearing as a series of unrelated decorative stones. Rather, This collection of five ellipsoid granite stones, scattered in a 200-foot radius in an almost semicircular formation and wrapping around the courtyard of the Nazarian Performing Arts Center, is the multi-piece work of art of Jonathan Bonner. The five stones vary in size and shape and are positioned sequentially from the shortest, measuring 2 feet high, to the tallest, measuring 8 feet in height. Perhaps the most intriguing feature of this sculpture is the fact that, despite their obvious size variations, each stone is of equal volume and weight. According to Jonathan Bonner, who was commissioned by the Rhode Island Council on the Arts, the sculpture represents the growth a student goes through during their college career.
One of the more beautiful types of statues found in public art are those known as a group called the equestrians. In Providence, there are three equestrians of note. The first, pictured here, is of Polish military hero General Kazimierz Pulaski. Pulaski fought to secure American independence during the American Revolution, but it wasn't until Justice for Poland Day in 1953 that the statue, marking the 200th anniversary of his birth, was dedicated. The story of Pulaski's valor and contributions to the cause of freedom can be found on pages 226 to 229 of the book. Major General Ambrose Burnside was a man of many talents. Perhaps least among them was his military acumen, yet that is what he's best known for. When first dedicated in 1887, the statue was located on the exact spot now occupied by the federal building that houses the Federal District Court. It stood on a 28-foot high granite base designed by New York artist Henry O. Avery. It faced the Soldiers and Sailors Monument that, as we saw earlier, was situated at the opposite end of Kennedy Plaza, or Exchange Place at the time, in front of City Hall. In 1906, with the construction of Union Station and the Federal Building, the statue was moved from its present location and given a new base. The design was modified by General William R. Walker, a prominent architect in the city of Providence. This is an early 1900s view of the statue from a slightly different perspective, with a newly constructed train station as the backdrop. This colorized postcard, colorized postcard from 1920 shows the area after completion, becoming known as Burnside Park because of the prominence of the statue as its focal point. The area was a source of pride for city residents. At the time, just about 50 years after the Union's great victory in the Civil War, Burnside still enjoyed hero status. The West Point graduate also served in the Mexican War and had a brief career in the manufacture of rifles. He even invented the Burnside breech-loading rifle, a gun that never really caught on. He left his job to answer the call of Rhode Island Governor William Sprague to command the 1st Rhode Island Volunteers and was highly regarded by President Lincoln. Lincoln even appointed Burnside to command the Army of the Potomac, replacing General George McClellan, who Lincoln believed was not aggressive enough in pursuing the Confederate Army. After some early victories, Burnside was handed responsibility for embarrassing defeats at Petersburg and Fredericksburg, the latter being one of the most lopsided battles of the Civil War. Despite his poor ability as a wartime general, Burnside remained exceedingly popular at home, and after the war was 3 times elected governor of Rhode Island, and then 2 times elected to the U.S. Senate. He died suddenly in 1881 at the age of 57 at his home in Bristol, just after the start of his second term in the Senate. His statue still stands proudly in Burnside Park, but it's often used by protesters and passersby as a resting place or a site of protest. Today, Burnside is perhaps best known for the style of facial hair that streamed down both sides of his face toward his chin, a feature we now call the sideburn. And as Paul Harvey used to say, now you know the rest of the story. As Heather mentioned when we viewed the Carrie Clock Tower, the love story that is Paul and Carrie Bajnati's is quite gripping and moving, and it's well worth the read. Just 5 years following Carrie's untimely death in 1893, Paul commissioned this fountain to be built in her hometown in her memory. The Bajnati Fountain, also known as the Carrie Brown Memorial, is one of the most beautiful fountains in all of Providence and perhaps the most beautiful in all of Rhode Island. It was cast by the Gorham Company and is comprised of 4 bronze statues at the center of a granite base that contains 234 spray outlets and a pinnacle spout. The four bronze figures represent the struggle of life, with life being symbolized by an angel wearing a mantle of truth that seems to be flowing from its shoulders. It struggles to break free from duty, passion, and avarice, represented by three bronze male figures. Despite the attempts to keep its soul, the angel and life are held down by the earthly tendencies. This dramatic depiction is the work of sculptor Enid Brindel, who studied under Rodin. Standing in front of the historic Providence Athenaeum at 250 Benefit Street is the most impressive Gothic fountain of historic significance, equal only to that of the Athenaeum. Though the Athenaeum was chartered in 1836, the fountain wasn't built until the following year. This gift of Anna Richmond was designed by Boston architectural firm of Ware and Van Brunt and cost about $600 to construct. It contains a drinking basin carved into a 10-feet high retaining wall. Four columns of polished Quincy granite support a molded arch in which are inscribed the words, "Come hither, everyone who thirsteth." The basis of the columns are sculpted from white Concord granite. A shell-like basin is filled with water pouring from a spigot above and subsequently overflowing into the second larger basin at ground level. Although legend has it that everyone who drinks the water is sure to return, water had not flowed to the fountain for over a decade. However, the good news is that on April 28, 2018, the Athenaeum announced that the plumbing had been repaired and water again started flowing to the fountain beginning on May 20th, 2018.
This 1963 treasure of sculptor Gilbert Franklin was the gift of Mrs. Murray S. Danforth, chairwoman of the Rhode Island School of Design's Division of Fine Arts and descendant of one of the institution's founders. The bronze work of art brings to life a piece of Greek mythology. According to legend, the musician Orpheus had the ability to charm anybody with his music. Overcome with the grief upon discovering that his wife Eurydice had died of a viper bite, he descends to the depths of hell to plead for his wife's return. So strong is the power of his music that it overcomes death itself, and the devil agrees to allow Eurydice to return to earth on the condition that Orpheus walk in front of her and not look back until both he and his wife have reached the upper world. As he enters the world of the living, an anxious Orpheus looks back at Eurydice, forgetting that she too must have entered the upper world before he could look back. She immediately vanishes from his sight, forever cast back into Hades. The sculpture depicts Orpheus watching the guide Hermes lead Eurydice back into death. Nestled within a cove of trees in a long, narrow park between the two travel lanes of Blackstone Boulevard stands a bronze remembrance to an adventurous girl whose life ended far too soon. Constance Witherby was a student at Providence's Lincoln School and spent much of her time writing poetry, playing sports, and engaging in activities that most adolescents just dreamed about. In her junior year, Constance decided to spend the summer vacationing in Europe with the cousin of her socialite mother. While enjoying the sightseeing, Constance wanted to engage in more strenuous activity that would quench her thirst for exercise. So, on a bright, sunlit August day, she decided to climb the Swiss Alps.
Doesn't everybody?
After one day of her climb, she felt fatigued. The next morning, she awoke with a slight fever, a condition that only worsened over the next few days. A Swiss doctor that examined her diagnosed her with a failing heart. Just a few days later, on August 30th, 1929, only 6 days short of her 16th birthday, Constance was buried in a small town in Switzerland. In 1930, Constance's mother, Dorothy, searching for a way to memorialize her daughter, collected her daughter's poems and had them printed in a limited edition called Sunshine and Stardust. She also purchased a 69,000 square foot piece of land at 210 Pittman Street and commissioned New York sculptor Gail Sherman Corbett to design a statue. The statue stood largely unnoticed until the spring of 1992 when it was vandalized by malcontents who saw it off and stole its arms. City officials decided to restore the work and relocate it to a busier location, where she now stands watch as each day hundreds of walkers, runners, and bikers pass by the charming figure. In 1925, Constance wrote a poem called Wish. In it, she may have well predicted her final station in life, writing, "I wish I could see a mermaid fair, with a glistening crown of pearls. I wish I could see a fountain plead in the moonlight, falling in swirls. I wish I could see a fairy spray of tinkling merry flower bells. I wish I could have a happy day in the quietest of shady dells. I wish I could hear a bird's gay song, the rustling of poplars at home. I wish I could take a journey long or by the seaside roam. Oh, I wish I could do what I want to do and have what I want to have. Though taken from the world far too soon, Constance's spirit lives on in both her poems and her statue that now watches the walkers, runners, and bikers pass by her daily as she stands in the quietest of shady dells. On the quiet and chilly evening of November 20th, 1849, while America's richest woman, Anna Jenkins, and her family slept, a fire broke out at their mansion on 383 Benefit Street in Providence. Alerted to the flames, the family dog, Black Prince, a large mastiff chained in the yard, broke free and ran to the house barking loudly. I said loudly. 17-year-old daughter Anna and her 15-year-old brother Moses were awakened by the barking and able to free themselves from the blaze. Their mother Anna and their youngest sister Sarah were not so lucky as they perished that night. A short time later, Anna married Westminster Street artist Thomas F. Hoppin, eventually moving into a house built in place of the fire-reduced home of Anna's youth. Though primarily a painter of spirited war and animal scenes, Hoppin felt compelled to memorialize the animal that saved his wife's life. He executed the striking bronze statue of the Hero Mastiff in 1851 and had it cast by the Gorham Company. It is such a striking example that when shown at the Crystal Palace in London, it won a gold medal from the New York Academy of Design. The bronze mastiff wears a thick studded collar and has a broken chain draped over his back. The statue took a prominent position as a lawn sculpture in the front yard of the Benefit Street Mansion, where it stood until 1896, when the family donated it to the city of Providence. It was placed in Roger Williams Park, where it has taken up several positions, including on the Frederick C. Green Memorial Boulevard and in the Japanese Gardens. Today it stands at the entrance of the park zoo, where, over the course of generations, it has become the park's mascot and a favorite among visitors, especially the children, many of whom stop to take a photo perched on the large dog's back. It is perhaps the most photographed statue in Rhode Island, with generations of families owning photos of their children atop Black Prince. Shown here are two such photos. The first is a throwback of me at the age of two in 1983, sitting atop Black Prince while my father, yes, that's my father, holds me on. The second photo, taken 31 years later in 2014, shows my five-year-old son atop the big dog while both my father and I live on.
I like to hear. Public art has become a most controversial subject in recent years with calls of removal of certain statues and memorials that some deem offensive, as well as the outright vandalism of others and the removal of some authorized or unauthorized from public view. This slide depicts four recent examples of desecration of public art. Let's take a look at each slide individually. The three examples of public art depicted here are a statue of Confederate General Robert E. Lee being removed on May 19, 2017, that's on the left, a statue of Confederate President Jefferson Davis in Richmond, Virginia, in the center, and an equestrian of Stonewall Jackson in Manassas, Virginia, on the right. For many months, government officials have fielded complaints from malcontents and those legitimately offended by the presence of these monuments because the public art remembers a time in history that spotlights some of the less desirable character traits, struggles, and actions of historic American citizens. The struggle between those who sought to preserve history and those offended by it came to a head in May 2017 when violent protests broke out in Charlottesville, North Carolina, sparked by the city's decision to take down the statue of Confederate General Robert E. Lee. The people who descended on Charlottesville were there to make a naked show of force for white supremacy, one letter read. It continued, "We are writing to say that we understand justice very differently from our grandfather's grandfather, and we wish to make it clear that his statue does not represent us." The Lee statue was not the only one in question, however. Similar protests broke out in front of the statue of Confederate President Jefferson Davis, located inside the National Statuary Hall at the U.S. Capitol and before Stonewall Jackson statue in Manassas, Virginia. This is a photograph of a memorial of those who died defending the Alamo. Lee Spencer White, a descendant of Gordon C. Jennings, who died at the Alamo, organized this rally of Alamo descendants. They gathered in protest in May 2017 to protest a decision by the San Antonio City Council, which voted to remove the memorial, at times called the Spirit of Sacrifice. The city wants to relocate the memorial, created in 1937 by Italian sculptor Pompeo Coppini, to a place where virtually no one can see it, according to the protesters. And this is the Bladensburg World War I Veterans Memorial in Bladensburg, Maryland. This monument stood in honor of local veterans for almost 100 years and is lawful under the First Amendment. In 2014, the American Humanist Association, a group that believes in being good without a God, filed a lawsuit alleging the cross-shaped memorial is unconstitutional and demanding that it be demolished, altered, or removed. They allege the cross carries an inherently religious message and creates the unmistakable appearance of honoring only Christian servicemen. The Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals agreed and ruled that the historic memorial must be torn down, writing, "The memorial excessively entangles the government in religion because the cross is a core symbol of Christianity and breaches the wall separating church and state." Judge Gregory, writing the minority opinion, said, "This memorial stands in witness to the valor, endurance, courage, and devotion of the 49 residents of Prince George's County, Maryland, who lost their lives in the great war for liberty of the world. I cannot agree that a monument so conceived and dedicated and that bears such witness violates the letter or spirit of the very Constitution those heroes died to defend." This photograph is a statue of Christopher Columbus located in New York Central Park. Here, vandals spray-painted the pedestal with phrases, "Hate will not be tolerated," and "Something's coming." The statue's hands were also splashed in red paint. The vandalism came weeks after New York Mayor Bill de Blasio announced the formation of a commission set to root out and topple statues and memorials representing symbols of hate in the Big Apple. In fact, in a concerted effort, statues of Columbus were vandalized not only in New York, but in Baltimore, Maryland, Providence, Rhode Island, Arago Park in Chicago, Illinois, as well as two places in Connecticut, Harbor Park in Middletown and Worcester Square in New Haven. Critics of Italian-born explorer Christopher Columbus accused him of enslaving and killing native populations when he first arrived in the Caribbean from Spain in 1492. Black Lives Matter vandals have targeted statues all around the nation. They've used public art as a means of disparaging the government and law enforcement. In the process, they have violated the rule of law and the private property rights of hundreds of innocent, hardworking American entrepreneurs. Thomas Owen said, "Americans once celebrated their history, but no more. Cultural Marxists and social justice warriors have succeeded in convincing a generation of American students that U.S. history is nothing but a record of racism and oppression." Owens is the academic dean of the Institute of World Politics in Washington and editor of the journal Orbis. "Memorials are not necessarily raised to celebrate, but to remember," he added. "The Confederate monuments under assault can be seen as cautionary reminders about pride and hubris." He noted in June 2017 that the war on the Confederate statues is just the beginning and wonders when they'll come for Washington, Jefferson, Madison, and the other founders. He didn't have to wait too long for his answer. Black Lives Matter targeted statues of Thomas Jefferson and Abraham Lincoln, both of whom were accused of owning slaves. Abraham Lincoln, slave owner. The Lincoln and Jefferson statues have also been targeted for defacement. In September 2017, about 100 students and faculty members at the University of Virginia gathered around a statue of its founder, Thomas Jefferson, and draped it in black fabric. They held a Black Lives Matter banner that read, "F white supremacy." This protest was in response to a UVA denial of a Black Student Alliance request to remove Confederate plaques from the rotunda and to ban white supremacists from campus. Those gathered around the statue chanted, "No Trump, no KKK, no racist UVA." Signs read, "Thomas Jefferson is a racist and a rapist." Even the New York Times, certainly not a bastion of conservatism in America, warned against the national trend of tearing down historic statues, stating that such campaigns will alienate moderates and mobilize the right to resist liberal policies. What bothers me is that the Times is less concerned about the loss of the public art and more the preservation of the history it represents, and more concerned about the effect the movement might have on liberalism. To my knowledge, only two people were prosecuted for the action or taking action regarding a work of public art. One was the former University of Mississippi student who waived indictment and pled guilty to placing a noose around the school statue of its first black student. Following a night of drinking, the trio of Sigma Pi Epsilon House students also draped the statue in a Confederate flag and placed a Confederate emblem on the statue. But the prosecution for the crime was for the commission of a hate crime, not for defacing the statue. 21-year-old Austin Reed Edenfield was charged with a misdemeanor, and though he faced 1 year in prison and a $100,000 fine, was given a novel sentence of 1 year probation and a requirement to write a report from a William Faulkner novel for his part in the crime. The judge showed leniency after Edenfield helped the government in the prosecution of another former student, Graham Philip Harris. Harris also pled guilty to the misdemeanor charge of threatening force to intimidate African-American students and employees at the university after prosecutors dropped a stiffer felony charge in exchange. Harris was given 6 months in prison, followed by 12 months of supervised release. A third student in the incident wasn't charged. The three said that Harris hatched the plan and often expressed ill will toward black people. They thought their actions would cause a sensation, and it certainly did for them. So the real question is, when will the assault on the nation's public art end? Will the desecration spread to other parts of the world? Will some religious group decide that statues of antiquity, including those to ancient gods, are offensive and must be removed or destroyed? Running Monumental Providence was an absolute delight, not only because of the challenge in finding the statues and researching their history and the meaning, but because I had the pleasure of working on the project with my daughter Heather, who in turn made the exercise a real family adventure by getting her 5-year-old son Casey involved in the research. Heather and Casey had, among other things, a job of finding and photographing many of the works of public art, and to this day, Casey doesn't pass by a statue without bringing it to his mother's attention. This is a display of some of the statues that Casey was photographed with. The book actually does make for a real fun scavenger hunt for the kids, grandkids, whatever. I'd like to wrap it up by quoting Paul Campbell and Richard Jordan, who observed, "Public art is everywhere and has served as an artistic form of cultural memory since the dawn of civilization. It's all around us. Yet some of these artistic masterpieces seem to hide in plain view, with thousands of otherwise unsuspecting and preoccupied passerby walking or riding past each day without even as much as a notice." I hope we were able to enlighten or at least entertain you in some small way tonight with the fascinating stories that are behind each of these works of art, and that we may have piqued your interest in locating and observing each of the pieces of public art that surround us. Our book sells for $20, it's available here, and it was written in such a way so as to enable you to easily locate each work. It's laid out in a format that enables you to take an easy walking tour of each monument, memorial, sculpture, and statue in Providence. We hope you will consider picking up a copy tonight or any of my other books, and we thank you for your kind attention. We'll be available to sign books if anyone's interested, and as we do, we leave you with a fond memory of this George M. Cohen classic. Thank you.
Does anybody remember this movie? Oh, it's a classic.
There we go.
Yeah. I had no bones.